evening. Can everyone hear me well? I hope. There we go. So I'm Matt Witkowski, the chair of the photography department at the Art Institute, and it is a pleasure and an honor to have Wolfgang Tillmans in Chicago for the first time in nearly a decade. This museum's interest in Tillmans' work goes back a bit longer, to 2003-2004, when the Society for Contemporary Art acquired for the Art Institute a made-to-order wall installation by Tillmans of 26 of his photographs, ranging from his earliest works to the abstract pieces he had begun making a couple of years before. I want to thank particularly Dirk Dennison for his instrumental help with that acquisition, which is on view, together with a purchase of more recent works in Griffin Court in the Modern Wing. I hope, if you haven't had a chance to go by the installation yet, that you'll go look at it after the talk. It's been itself installed according to the artist's own careful conception. I want to give thanks as well to our exhibition manager, Becca Schlossberg, our preparator, Jim Ischke, photo conservator Sylvie Penichon, and colleagues in the departments of registration and modern and contemporary art for guaranteeing the success of the 26-part installation. All the lectures and programs that take place in this museum are ably overseen by the Department of Education. This evening, we're also indebted to the sustaining fellows and to the event chairs, Margie Feitler and Christine Pope. And Christine will speak to you at the end of the lecture. This talk is the first in an annual keynote lecture series named for Hugh Edwards. And so I want to tell you something about Hugh Edwards, whom you have before you there. He was a pioneering force for photography at the Art Institute. Edwards moved to Chicago in the late 1920s from Paducah, Kentucky, with a high school education and some experience in a local library. He was an autodidact and a bookworm, and in 1929, he landed a job here at our newly founded Ryerson Library. In addition to books, Hugh Edwards loved photography. He studied the craft of photography, and he had a private sideline in creative photography that lasted several decades. He saw in the 1930s the annual photographic salons that were being held at this museum. And then he got to see curated shows that were either put on or borrowed by the Department of Prints and Drawings. And then at last in the 1950s, Edwards was able to see the creation of a gallery for photography exhibitions that was in the space that's now occupied by the Michigan Avenue Coat Room, a point of detailed interest. But through all those years, and Hugh Edwards had nothing to do with any of those developments, there was no curator of photography. Edwards became that curator in 1959, 30 years after starting at the Art Institute. He held the position for 12 years, and in that role added thousands of photographs to the collection, curated dozens of exhibitions, and helped launch a number of significant careers, including those of Robert Frank and Danny Lyon. Hugh Edwards retired in 1970 at a point when there was still next to no museum curators of photographs anywhere in the world. The great point in having photography in a museum, he commented at the end of his life, is to show it with other things so that people can realize what its differences and what its superiorities are and also its shortcomings. That broad-mindedness regarding photography as an art form and that willingness to open up the field to comparisons and challenges at a big encyclopedic museum such as ours will hopefully animate every subsequent edition of the Hugh Edwards Lecture. They will certainly do so tonight. And I want to thank, above all, the Cross Purposes Foundation, an anonymous foundation founded by two artists, a painter and a photographer, for underwriting the annual Hugh Edwards Lecture as a tribute and a challenge to the field of photography. And so I want to very much to thank Wolfgang Tillmans for coming from Berlin to inaugurate this series. Tillmans makes an ideal first Edwards lecturer. He's abundantly celebrated, yet still fresh in his work and the ways of presenting it. He's a photographer who thinks deeply about how images look in a gallery, but also how they feel between your fingers in the pages of a book. Tillmans is the winner of the coveted Turner Prize. He's an artist trustee of Tate London. He's a member of the Akademie der Künste in Berlin, and he's also a member of the Royal Academy of Arts in London. He holds a long-standing professorship at the Städel Art School in Frankfurt. These are all signal indications of prestige, but they haven't in any way removed Tillmans from the vibrancy of youth culture, particularly as we see it in fashion and music. He moves fluidly between art galleries and commercial magazines, between the classroom and the nightclub. Tillmans creates, he also performs. The great quality of liveness that we get out of his photographs, his books, his installations, is the direct expression of art as performance that keeps his work moving in every sense of the word. Tonight's lecture will undoubtedly be a unique performance as well. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Wolfgang Tillmans.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. And it really is a great pleasure to be back in Chicago. I had a wonderful time back in 2005 on an initial visit preparing the exhibition at the MCA in 2006. And it was such a great discovery to realize that there is such a gem between LA and New York. So I was showing you a video before Matthew came on, which is a video called Copier, and it's actually an homage to the instrument, to the my first artistic instrument that I found with which I could express myself fully. I was, as a teenager, initially completely obsessed with astronomy, but then at the age of 14, I suddenly got infatuated with a worldly star, with Boy George of Culture Club, and I was starting to experiment with all sorts of self-expression, painting, drawing, making clothes, as you can see on the left, or I was also singing, and the one thing that I didn't do was photograph, because my father was and still is an avid amateur photographer using a 2.25 camera, and so was my grandfather, and so was my great grandmother, and you know, the one thing a rebellious, eccentric teenager doesn't want to do is express himself through the means that his parents use. And so I feel fortunate that I didn't sort of grow up thinking I would be a photographer. On the other hand, I was always aware of photography, and I loved photography in newspapers, in particular in the newspaper, the Frankfurter Allgemeine, that my parents subscribed to, as well as Time magazine, which my father subscribed to, and those little printed photographs always seemed to contain the entire world in some way. And I remember at the age of 10 or 11, sort of looking for ages at the pictures in Time magazine of the Guyana Jonestown suicide cult, and all sorts of other events, and this sort of thing that happens in the brain when you look actually at some dyes on paper, but they open up an entire world in your brain, and that I felt intuitively from this early moment onwards, but it took me about 7 years, 8 years, until at the age of 18, when I discovered a black and white special photocopier in the local copy shop where I wanted to make a fanzine. And I stumbled across this new arrival at the copy shop, and it said Canon laser copier. I said, laser, wow. And it turned out to be the first digital photocopier, which basically had a scanner, which also was the first time that I heard the word scanner. And so this was in 1986, and it printed then the exposed the image with a laser to the drum, and then from the drum the particles, the toner particles, would be transferred to the paper, rather than in traditional photocopiers that were in use into the early 2000s that use a mirror and lens to charge the drum. And I somehow immediately felt an incredible potential in this machine, which was that it was the first photocopier that could translate photographs in halftone. All other photocopiers could only really do black or white or dirty, rough gradations. And this was early days in digital, obviously, and the photocopier was making all sorts of artifacts, which you can, for example, see on the left. Was a 12 by 16 inch size photocopy, and I used, in this case, a photograph I took on an Interrail trip to Edinburgh, I was just so struck by this translation. On the one hand, it was flattening a color holiday picture, and on the other hand, there was stuff added to it that I had no control over. And this somehow set the tone to maybe my whole practice following the 28 years since I made these. This interplay of chance and control, to explore my medium as far as I can and as rigid as I can, and on the other hand, to know when to stop and when to let go. And I felt that these photocopies, which were really technically industrially pre-produced pieces of paper, which were, so to speak, charged or transformed with the touch of a button, without me touching them, that they had an incredible beauty and textural richness, which I felt surpassed the drawings or other media that I used, and I guess that was a real watershed moment, which I then realized that this sort of mechanical expression was really how I could best speak, or wanted to speak. And then I moved to Hamburg after school and quickly got myself the first exhibition in a local arts cafe, and things went on from there. And then I got a slightly more bigger exhibition, and I felt the need that now I should actually buy myself a camera, because before I was just using my mother's sort of point and shoot camera for holiday trips, or I was photocopying found photographs in kind of a parallel, almost unknowing way to what was going on under the label of appropriation art in New York. But really, I feel fortunate that I never had this problem of differentiating photography from painting, because when I started to go to museums around the age of 15, 16, I was fortunate that there were the cities of Cologne and Düsseldorf, as well as Paris, relatively nearby, and so I could see the pop artists like Rauschenberg and Warhol, as well as the Germans painters like Polke and Richter. I could see them all there, very present in the museums, and I somehow naturally felt that these are all paintings that are actually in their imagery lens derived. They all have a photographic origin, and I think that I naturally connected with this experience from valuing newsprint and magazine photographs. And so, because I felt that, well, a Warhol is a printed, a silk-screened photograph, I never felt really much of a difference between what I was doing. And I was just feeling I'm making pictures without painting them. I wanted to make contemporary pictures and wanted to use whatever that was new to me that obviously hadn't been done in the same way before. And this is like photographically what I always consider my first picture around my 18th birthday. And it's this sort of affirmative, self-affirmative gesture of I am. Like it is also my first maybe abstract picture and the first self-portrait in a way, because it is simply photographing down my t-shirt and leg on sand. And after a while, realized that with his camera that I then bought, and that was a lucky one because I wanted to buy actually also a little point-and-shoot camera, and there was a great camera sales guy, and he sold me a professional Contax SLR, which I really didn't intend to, and so I walked out with this great camera with a 50mm Carl Zeiss lens used, and within half a year, I realized that I could speak better with this instrument than through the path of distortion and reduction that the photocopier provided. And then I was moving to Hamburg, or I was living in Hamburg at the time, and for the first time I was able to participate in youth culture, in proper nightlife, and be part of what I before only read about passionately in ID magazine, which I kept reading, which reported on the underground of London, and the emerging dance scene of house music and acid house, and so my sort of leaving home, starting to live my own life, was in 87, and it sort of fell into the exactly same moment as house music that, as you know, comes from this city, completely exploded in Europe and became the predominant subculture of the time. And suddenly there were people getting high on ecstasy and leaving all their sort of inhibitions behind in terms of style and status, because the 80s were, of course, all about power dressing and I don't know, I don't need to list the 80s, but they were also great in the early 80s, mid 80s, but then it all sort of didn't become so interesting, and it was probably getting all more about money and status, and so this acid house revolution felt like a deeply political thing, we were. I mean, just I don't know. Like when I came 9 years ago to Chicago, I asked the odd people, and I didn't really feel that anybody was aware of the huge importance, but also the pure creativity of what went on here. Artists like Tyree Cooper, his song "I Am" or "Acid Over," I can still listen to this day, and it gives me goosebumps. This really felt like a new beginning, a new, like, this is changing the world. I started to take my camera into the nightclub because I bought a cheap flash for $20, and I wanted to show what's going on. And I felt that nightlife actually had this utopian political quality, where people left their pecking orders behind, and where there was suddenly a polysexual environment, not divided between gay and straight, and straight guys were suddenly all peaceful and not having drunken fights, but were hugging each other high on E. This is a group of pictures I took in 92, so a little bit later than in, I guess at the same time than in 89, after a year after Acid House really blew big in Europe. The Berlin Wall came down, and it seemed even more so like a new beginning and a non-ideological time coming. This feeling that moved me so strongly, I was interested in also trying to translate, like, where is that feeling? And I found just how I found it, the meaning in the surface of the photocopy, in the minute texture in the photocopies. I felt that there was deep meaning in nightlife, in the surface, the skin, the clothes, the sweat. Was translating something that went beyond just the banal moment, and so these nightlife, I felt and still feel, is incredibly rich. There's a video that I made in 2002 called Light's Body, which is just following the lights, the sort of robotic mechanical lights moving under the ceiling of a couple of nightclubs where I filmed them on heaving Saturday nights. And the only thing human you see is specks of dust sometimes going through the light beams, which is most likely human skin, which is blown up or dust from the clothes. So this interconnection of visual richness and the political potential of nightlife stays a central interest it's an important interest of mine, which I go in and out of, you know, like I don't photograph every time I go out. It's actually quite rare, but that I photograph, not that I go out. But for example, this is a sad interpretation of where we are at in Russia. This is the last remaining gay disco in St. Petersburg, where I went three times last year, taking part in the Biennale Manifesta. And it was this like multi-story building, but it was completely shuttered, and there was like one tiny rainbow flag next to a sort of shut door that looked all closed. And I mean, giving the rainbow flag also some real meaning again, that one should never take for granted where we are now, because people, I mean, traditionally St. Petersburg was the most liberal city of Russia. All gay and lesbians that could did move to St. Petersburg, and people my age, I'm 46, I mean, they told me like it was incredible, it was so great in the 90s, and it was like everything was free and open and happening. And who would have thought that 20 years later, it is an entirely bleak situation there now for the LGBT community. So I always saw nightlife not as a superficial thing and not as a thing disconnected from activism. So, you know, this guy is one of 10 people I portrayed in St. Petersburg on my last visit, and they are bravely running the last remaining couple of organizations promoting or informing people about the facts. And in London, we can go to demonstrations, we can even go demonstrate. Thousands and thousands of people went to the streets to demonstrate against the last Pope, Ratzinger, in London, including John Waters. having this lecture in honor of Hugh Edwards, back in his days, he could not express himself in the way that he may have wanted to, and I'm just always aware that the freedom that we got today is always under threat somewhere. This interest in form, the meaning of the surface, the reading the surface, is a, as I said, an ongoing interest, and which extends to really an interest in the three-dimensional world, because of course everything I see is three-dimensional, and the work that I do is translate that into two-dimensional photographs, pictures. And these is a family of pictures which I began in 1991, and I occasionally add to, called Drapery. And I found photography an incredibly economical medium, allowing me to not have to put these jeans on a plinth under a plexiglass hood, but actually photograph them and preserve this and translate this temporary sculpture. And just have it's just much easier to deal with this. And paper in 2000, I realized this like paper remains of this central interest to me, and how this sheet of paper. The photographic paper then, since the early 90s, color photographic paper, is transformed, and I started to photograph paper, and then from 2001, photographic paper, which I exposed previously in the darkroom, and began this group of pictures called Paper Drop, which initially the name was really more alluding to an idea of falling. And I've always liked this, that there is some mathematical function, really, that it's like a graph that between gravity and surface tension that creates this shape. And then from 2005, I started to turn photographic paper onto itself, and suddenly the name Paper Drop became like a self-fulfilling prophecy. This is a Paper Drop reversed green from 2011. And from my first proper exhibition, 1993, at Daniel Buchholz in Cologne, I installed my photographs taped to the wall. For the first 7 years, there were no frames, and this was because I wanted to show the beauty of the object of the photograph, and I found a way how to fasten them to the wall without anything touching the delicate emulsion of the image, and this was often misunderstood as a way of like a grunge aesthetic, as a careless aesthetic, but indeed it was actually the highest, it was the most minimal presentation. So the magazine page, the photocopy, the photograph, they have always been three-dimensional objects to me, very shallow cubes, so to speak, but they do have a dimension into the space. But it took me 12 years exploring that until I then actually made the seemingly obvious step and making photographs into real, like three-dimensional shaped objects, which I did since 2005 under the name Lighter. So these are photographs that no longer represent anything other than themselves. because, you know, normally a photograph is always supposed to represent something else. It's only a tool to show something else, but not itself. And this is simply answering back, you're looking at me. In 2010, I was invited by the British Arts Council collection to exhibit their acquisition of 12 works in the Walker Art Gallery in Liverpool, which is like the third most important Old Masters museum in Britain. And they allowed me carte blanche as to how and what I wanted to rearrange in the museum. And one wall caught my particular interest, which was this wall here. And I had three paintings removed, the two on top and one on the right, and left the and revealed the shadows that I expected behind. And on the left is William Turner, who is obviously always famed for his depiction of light. And in the middle is a painting by no one else other than Daguerre, the French inventor of photography. And on the right, I placed two of my lighter works, which are, in the case of the left one, a direct representation of the folded object being exposed in the darkroom to a different colored light. So it was this many different layers of exposure and the exposure to the tapestry. This is a recent studio still life. A work that I first did in 1999. I also showed that in Chicago in 2006. And these are four different installations comprising of photographs of soldiers, which I collected from newspapers throughout the 1990s. And they explore the proliferation of an image type that I found curious during the 90s in particular, sort of going on till today, that it is actually the only news image that makes it to the front page of a person that is not famous and not doing anything of interest. And when you look now, I mean, when you once you're aware, you notice that there are constantly pictures of just a soldier or two soldiers standing, or one smoking, or there's an African one standing. On the top right is a Croatian one. There are two Americans talking, and I was wondering, what is the reason we are shown these pictures all the time? And I had this theory that it might be to keep up a sense of threat in the 90s, you know, this perception of the Cold War is over, but that there is actually a constant presence of the potential of military violence, which of course also was there throughout the 90s. But it wasn't depicted in its violence. It was just sort of soldiers were peacekeepers. And this interest in newspapers translated and continued and translated it itself into a project that I began in 2005 called Truth Study Center, which is quite a mouthful, but it came from the realization that after the turn of the decade, we were suddenly not so much in a non-ideological era anymore, and I found myself reading insane claims for absolute truths, like the South African health minister saying that HIV is not the cause of AIDS, or the creationists in the United States, or the fundamentalism of 9/11 and onwards, and suddenly there were all these struggling claims for truth, and I felt that sometimes what I read in commentary or what I read in sensible commentary was expressing myself better than how I could maybe do it in a photograph. And so the 2000s were a time where I felt personally the need to decelerate the production of camera pictures. Of course, it seems absurd when I say, like, around the end of the 90s, I felt there was already an incredibly accelerated production of pictures, because of course now we're talking, no? But I felt that inserting non-camera-made pictures into my exhibitions and books was drawing again a different attention to the reading and the surface of photographs and picture making. We come back to this, but then after the, so these table installations were a way to really speak about the contradictions that I felt in boiling in all sorts of parts of the world. You know, the claim, the absolute claim that there are weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, you know, which turned out to be a falsehood and potentially a active lie, you know, that bending the truth got us partially into the mess that we're in today. And this, so I've fluctuated between these table installations and, on the other hand, making large-scale non-figurative works and exploring further this idea of the materiality of pictures. And around 2009, I felt that the world that I would want to take a look at the world outside of my studio, but also outside of my known circle of friends and the known routes in the cities I lived in. And I started to deliberately travel to places that had nothing to do with me exhibiting there, and I wanted to see what does the world look like 20 years after I sort of started to make pictures. And this slowly, not so slowly, but it did take like 4 years until in 2012 I came to a first conclusion with the book Neue Welt and the exhibition Neue Welt in Kunsthalle Zürich, and which was really coinciding with the use of digital camera, which I hadn't used really properly until 2009. And when I realized in 2009 that there is now a portable SLR that has a chip the size, exactly the size of 35 millimeter film, I realized that now sticking to film would be nostalgic, because the reason why I never was interested in digital was that the optics weren't the same. You know, they were tiny chips, and so they created a different depth of field, and just I could always tell digital pictures purely from the optical feel difference. But suddenly I had an instrument in my hands that was as sharp as a large format, like 5.4 camera. Whereas in the past, up till then, I often talked about that I want my pictures to approximate what it feels like to look through my eyes. I mean, we know that what the eyes actually see is very different from what then the brain computes out of it. But this sort of level of information and color and sense of reality of my eyes has been really my guiding principle. So I was never really interested in special effects, and I could be admiring large format photography, but it wouldn't really touch me, because it wouldn't be like my visual experience. And so it was a years-long process, 2009, 10, 11, 12, until I had sort of relearned my language and dealt with this incredible focus that was suddenly at in every photograph. And at the end of this learning period, I realized that actually now I can speak with these pictures, because in the meantime, the entire world has gone high digital, high definition. And it somehow is now feeling how the world feels like. And I'm just very grateful that I did this move when I did it voluntarily. I wasn't forced, but because a year later, Fuji stopped making the film that I was using. So it was, you know, I felt I did it as a free man. And it was really a radical, and I mean, not, well, radical, I don't know, but a complete sort of shifting of a perspective in trying to look at cities like London, where I live for the last 25 years, and see it in new ways, as well as going to places like Papua New Guinea or Ushuaia in Tierra del Fuego, and really see what and see in a deliberately superficial way what the world looks like now in, of course, the most incomplete way that comes with the impossibility of trying to record the entire world. Mm. This is, I think I might want to title this Shit Buildings Going Up Left, Right and Center. This is sort of this global phenomenon that I encountered all over the world of these cheap structures that are basically IKEA shelves And then clad with some friendly geometric facade, and here encroaching on my studio, which I rented until 2011 in the upper floor of that 50s building. And so that studio is history, and I am now the studio, the main studio is in Berlin, but I live between London and Berlin. And this, I've somehow always deeply felt that whatever I see looks the way it looks for a reason. You know, like, I mean, this may sound like a banal truism, and it may well be so, but there's always a reason behind how things are shaped. And I, therefore, I feel that an acute study of the surface of things is actually maybe the only thing I have. And if, in any way, if you try to go deeper, if you cut deeper, you will only see another surface. And I've often mistrusted when people call something superficial, because I think denouncing something as superficial is really just not seeing the depth in the surface. And something, for example, that I in general had often observed was cars and how cars reflect in their superficial appearance the desires and aspirations of their time, and in particular of 5 years before their time when they came to the market, and dreams and wishes of society at large. And in around 10 years ago, I observed how the headlights of cars slowly morphed from the friendly round eyes in the 90s and previous decades, and all square, but also friendly seeming faces, to these extreme shark-eyed light sculptures, you know, which on the one hand promise a highly complex optical instrument, and on the other hand give a really mean look. And I found this is a very striking illustration of the connection of surface and deeper and the reading of the nature of what's behind it. Because I feel this transition, this extreme look that we're looking at now, is mirroring the extremely toughened competitiveness and sort of much more selfish stance in the world, in the economy. And here illustrated with these three BMWs from the 90s, the noughties, and today, where the current model looks like a grotesque Japanese manga face. And it goes across the countries, you know, like American cars, Japanese cars, Korean cars, German cars. And it's an aggression on the street that no one talks about, and cars are never really talked about as this sort of massive visual presence that they are. And I just last month published a small book, artist book, with Walter Koenig called The Cars. And just looking without I mean, I'm not looking at judgment, with judgment at them, like these lights. I could only also recognize maybe in the first place because I was also fascinated by them. By the optics, you know, I always have an interest in optics and light objects, and so I'm fascinated by cars. I like them, and they are obviously a necessity and a global, also an incredible means of freedom for an individual, even though as a whole they are, of course, getting more and more unsustainable. So I see my work, I mean, there are different aspects, of course, and there are fictitious scenarios that I set up but a large part of my work is really studying surfaces, studying the world in its three-dimensional, in the surface that covers its three-dimensionality, and translate that into pictures, I do it without judgment, but not without criticality, and this is an interesting, clear example again how the surface carries an immediate record of time, and this is a portico of the Berliner Cathedral, and where the shrapnel wounds of the Second World War had been patched up by what looks like these some digital pixel manipulation, but it's done in stone. And the picture and reality, this dichotomy between abstraction and figuration has also been something that maybe due to these early photocopy experiences that anyway a picture of a black, fully black photocopy, it is an object, it is a thing, and it is also a picture of something. And this is, for example, Lake Michigan. Also a gradation of color. And this is your beautiful city. That becomes suddenly something, something just with this little insertion, these other blue surfaces are no less, are still not water. You know, it's only the eye that sees this as, reads this as water. And that is, of course, the great power of photography, that the brain, as soon as it recognizes something as photographic, not painted with oil, it translates whatever it sees, it tries to translate that into something real. And this is an industrial surface of Chicago. And even though I have a huge interest in architecture, I only on the day when I arrived on Tuesday, when I took these photographs, did it dawn on me, and did I really understand this incredible idea of just doing these double T, what are they called? T bars or I-beams, to weld them to the facade of his buildings and turn and make this fusion of surface and content like long before later architectural styles obviously explored that. Another curious observation that I made also in previous visits to the US is this morphing of underwear into Under Armour, and this sort of Nike now follows with combat, with compression fit for a locked-in feel, which, you know, like is, you know, it's very much on the surface. No? But you would think like 20 years ago, did people want a locked-in feel? It's sort of really the thing, it reminds me of the rubber scene. No? It's, and what is this, sort of what's going on here? No? That, that there's like a complete emergence of this sort of making your body a machine and armor and it's sort of as close to the surface of your body, as tight as possible, but also kind of as prudish as possible. And this idea, I guess, that the country is under a constant threat, right? Like there are unidentified threats all the time. I mean, there are, of course, real threats, but how this translates into everyday life and the vernacular of consumerism is, I mean, like always quite striking. When I saw this, on the Michigan Avenue, no? The Under Armour house. So this is a view of one of the two large Neue Welt exhibitions, which I titled Neue Welt because New World was, of course, taken already by America, and Neue Welt has this 1920s feel of new objectivity, Bauhaus or Germany, and an attempt of continental European modernist attempt of looking at the world and trying to also categorize it in typologies. You know, long tradition founded by the Karl Blossfelds and August Sanders, something which I grew up with throughout the Becher School, but I always felt that is, I take that for granted. This was just a reminder that I've been speaking 55 minutes. Is it okay, 20 more? Yeah. And then I'll ask for more. That I felt I can totally see myself and my own experience in these typologies, and I am a child of modernism, but maybe that's exactly why I don't need to do that anymore. And so I never felt the need to work in series. I often feel that in photography, seriality makes the project serious. And I never felt that way, and I felt like, why lock myself down to photograph only one subject matter when my experience of the world is just of a multitude. And for a long time, architecture had interested me because it is nothing influences the experience of our lives as much as architecture, I would say. Maybe medicine, probably even more so, but every day we are, of course, constantly and always surrounded by architecture. And I find it striking how little that is discussed, how things are made, how things are built, what the exact influence of this and that policy and material and choice of detail means to the quality of life of millions of people. And in around 8 years, 7 years ago, for the first time thought of the name Book for Architects, which was born out of a desire to more communicate with architects and maybe feed back also how I see architecture function in reality in a quite a different way from the idealized architecture photography that one knows, which tries to exactly shut out life, shut out people, shut out cars, and really tries to look like a photo, like architects. An architect told me, they are designing buildings for photographs, and in reverse. So it's a very interlocked relation, which photographs of buildings then are also always straightened, perspectivally straightened, which is a perspective that isn't at all how I see the world. And if it is, also, as part of the Neue Welt project, which took me to 37 countries, I accumulated a vast amount of pictures of architecture, and of course, most striking is that the majority of all built structures in the world are built without architects, and then there are. There's this global language of what I call cladding, which is like all over the world. And like here, this is in Jeddah in Saudi Arabia. And this interest in building I expressed in the 1990s, early 2000s, with a group of pictures of cities from above, views from above, where I was fascinated by the fact that a city is always bigger than what anybody, any one person can control. That it is this sum of innumerable, uncountable individual acts, where each time the person acting, be it the client or the architect, thought that they found a really good solution for this issue, this problem, this project. And then, of course, time goes by, the needs change, the use changes, and every ideal solution then gets something stuck onto, and of course the neighbors ruin the clarity, and it's this impurity of architecture that I find also incredibly lively and incredibly human. And that I wanted to express, like the good solutions, hilarious solutions, the bad solutions, and the lots and lots of random and not so special solutions. I try to keep religion out, and this is actually not in the project. This picture I showed instead at Manifesta in St. Petersburg as a commentary on the sort of virulent religionization of Russia via the Putin regime, and they put up these concrete bunkers everywhere and then put a spray on historic facade for these Orthodox churches. And this is in Moscow, 2009. So it's a long going campaign and trying to, I think, build a church within a kilometer of each other in what was for 80 years a non-religious country. In 2011, I started to introduce a new form of layout into my books, which I had really been in the very early 90s exploring a little bit in my installations, where there had been some overlaps of prints on the wall, but then very much so in the table installations, where there was a layering of multi-layers of material that was, obviously creating visual interest. I mean, joy. Even it's a fun but very efficient way of effective way of creating meaning oscillate between very specific things you're saying and very random things you're saying. And in these layouts, occasionally in books, I drop pictures on top of each other. And found that even though some information is taken away, there is it creates actually new pictures, and it's kind of the only way of the computer helping me make new pictures. I have absolutely no use in with Photoshop, and I don't manipulate my photographs. I don't move any pixels around, and that's why I consider myself to this date an analog photographer, because where the light beam hits the sensor, that pixel remains there, and no pixel will be removed, nothing will be shifted around, and of course I still use the same techniques that used to be available in the dark room, exposure, color, these, I call them double exposures, these pictures I make with the computer, are really my way of maybe making new pictures with a computer. But they remain really close to a tactile, three-dimensional experience, but when printed, they have this incredible flatness. This and the previous picture were taken in Haiti a year after the devastating earthquake of 2010. And so this amount of architectural pictures, I was not really able to show in its depth, but I kept writing down this book for architects as a reminder. The larger project Neue Welt seemed more important, more urgent, and the moment you put more than 30% of an exhibition architecture photographs, the whole show tilts to become an architecture show. And it was a great fortunate thing that Rem Koolhaas invited me to contribute to his architecture biennale last year in Venice, because he had heard from a former assistant of mine, Federico, that this project was brewing in the back of my mind, and it became clear to me that in the room that Rem gave me at the end of his Elements of Architecture exhibition, the only way again to really deal with the amount of pictures was to find a way to project them, because on the wall I would only be able to again fit maybe 60 maximum, and fortunately at exactly that, like 6 months before, I discovered that Sony put out these 4K projectors which have four times the resolution of high definition. So there are 8 million pixels in the image, and for the first time since slide projection did I find a quality that where I was happy with showing my pictures as originals projected. And then I researched how I wanted to configure this in the room, and soon came to the conclusion that opposite walls or too far apart projections would really only create a nervousness in the viewer, fearing to miss something. And so it ended up being an installation in a corner of the room, so two projectors, and then a very close-up seating, or fairly close-up seating, where you could be fairly immersed in this panorama of pictures, which often included more than one picture per screen, but I wanted to stay well clear of the language of AV and fancy video projection of and so everything, I mean, it is super high tech, but there's no fades, no blending of pictures into each other, and no sequenced sort of appearance of pictures. It's just always two screens appearing at the same time, and but at that data rate, it was a very big technical challenge a year and a half ago, and now already a year later, it's a manageable task. This is again an interesting picture where sort of the surface of things carries then this immediate political message or meaning. This is London Gatwick Airport, and the sign reads "Rest of World Passports." showing the European perspective on the world. And really, in most pictures that you've seen, there is technology at a very central, plays a central role, either behind the lens or in front of the lens. A lot of the pictures were not would not have been possible to make 10 years ago, or in this case, there's technology in a favela in Ushuaia, in the most southern bit of Argentina, where they built a shanty town using computer-aided designed styrofoam packaging as heat insulation. So this came, and finally this work was then called, I called it Book for Architects, and even though it actually isn't a book, it's a two-channel video installation or a film of stills. And this is a sort of beautiful image of surface, and rather than doing up the facade, people in Moscow put these grates above the pavement to protect the pedestrians from the predictable thing that's going to happen. Delhi. São Paulo. No. Oops. Oh, well, probably better to speed up a little. this, for example, is I mean, like, the project is showing how architecture looks to me. It's not using shift lenses, not using wide-angle lenses, trying to show what it feels like. And but there's one little campaigning moment, which is something that angers me for many, many years, is whenever I'm in public events like the Biennale in Venice, or concerts, or on the left in the Vatican City, or on the right Versailles Castle. There are always women waiting in line to use the toilet, and men walking past not having to wait. And I just never understand why on earth are architects building toilets for men and women with the same size footprint, square footage, when it's obvious that they operate very differently. Have to speed up, and this is can't really talk about this. This is from 1997, called Concorde, about the supersonic collaboration between France and Britain. Which was at the same time 56 pictures of this flying vision of a future, a super future through technology that people dreamed of and tried to realize in the 60s, and which was never attainable to my generation in the 90s. But the plane was still flying every day twice between London and New York. And every time you saw it, you had this moment of specialness and this projection of hope onto technology surpassing time and space. And something of ongoing interest technically as well as scientifically and politically are borders. And this is a picture called Tag-Nacht, as in day-night. And it always fascinates me on planes that this is like literally the shadow of Earth and there's night at the bottom and still day above. And what can be seen and recorded, and the very limit of what can be recorded with any given medium is of course of huge political, of huge scientific, of huge economical meaning, and but also of huge aesthetic interest. And when I started to go explore the limits of this new digital camera, I realized that I could take astrophotographs from flying aircraft, which of course seemed like an absurdity, but at the sort of highest sensitivity, I could achieve an exposure time short enough for the plane not to move. And so this picture is called In-Flight Astro 2. And because the sensor is sort of pushed to its very limit, where it cannot really discern, is this information or is this noise? You know, is this just an electron flickering or is this a star? This noise and stars are merging into an indistinguishable soup. I find that really quite beautiful, no? How like the biggest unit, a star, and the sort of most inconsequential thing, like a speck of on the electronic bitmap, appears as almost the same. How are we doing for? Yes, I click through the pictures. This was at the European Southern Observatory in Chile, where I found that astronomers have exactly the same problem distinguishing noise from a galaxy. This is a group of pictures called Silver, which I began in 1998, really the first family of non-figurative pictures. Where the process of photography shows itself in the materiality of silver residue and processing chemicals on the surface of paper being fed through a dirtied up printing a processing machine. These are large scale works, like 8 feet. So there is this interest in what can be photographed, the matter, and viscosity. The This is a very recent picture which will be premiered in Osaka in the summer. We'll have a big exhibition at the National Museum of Modern Art. And then in September at my gallery in New York. And so these interests in all these varying interests happen concurrently, and there's also this ongoing small group of growing pictures of nightlife, of friends, of various interactions. And so I can't talk about these. This is a They're called end of broadcast. Okay. I'll just click through. Thank you very much.